Hello, my name is Bakyt Azimkanov, and today we'll be taking a walk down the memory lane with none other than Professor Ivan Damgård. In 1988, the global academia was introduced to multi-party computation, today widely known as MPC. The paper written by Professor Damgård turned many heads in the research community. A PhD student in Jutland was the talk of the academic world. So I sat down with Professor Damgård here in Aarhus University, where the MPC's journey began 35 years ago. You're watching our special edition, MPC at 35. Hello, Professor Damgård. Welcome to our special edition. I will start with a very, very easy question. So Sir Isaac Newton's three laws of physics were inspired by a falling apple. And then Dmitry Mendeleev saw the elements fall into places on the periodic table in his dream. So what was it for multi-party computation for then a 32-year-old Ivan?
Yeah, so that's always a good question. Where do ideas come from? But I guess I can tell you the story that sort of happened around it. So I was a PhD student from Aarhus University, and I was visiting at the time CWI, which is a research center for mathematics and computer science in Amsterdam. And I met this guy called Jeroen van der Graaf, who were, you know, thinking similar things that I was thinking. And we kind of started, I guess, from the idea of zero knowledge, which was an existing concept at the time. It's from 84. And it's probably well known in the community what this is. It's this idea that I have some secret data. I can prove to you that I have, for instance, a proof of a mathematical statement. You get convinced beyond any reasonable doubt, but you learn nothing except for the fact that I have the data, that my data satisfies these constraints. So we started thinking, what if we had several people that had data that they want to keep secret? And we still want to, say, verify something about this data. So we kind of thought of this as being a generalization of zero knowledge. What would this then take? What would the solution look like? And we came up with stuff, and this is then that later, you know, crystallized in those papers you were talking about.
So between 84 and 88, these ideas were being distilled, crystallized, and formed and structured, and then ultimately it turned into a research paper that actually turned many heads in the academic world.
Yeah, sure. So in fact, what we didn't know was that other people were also thinking similar thoughts, but we had no idea. We were just young PhD students with not that big a horizon at the time, I guess. So lots of things came out at the same time. And I guess that's what happens many times, that when the world is ready for an idea, then it sort of pops up in different places.
So when the paper titled Multiparty Unconditionally Secure Protocols was published 35 years ago, you just received your PhD at that time, and in 1988, did you ever imagine that someday the computing power will allow practical applications of MPC? And back then, what was your wildest MPC-related imagination?
I would say that already at the time, like 87, 88, we had some thoughts that maybe this could be used for something in practice. Because, you see, the point is that the computation involved in verifying my secret data and zero knowledge, this has to be kind of very complicated, because otherwise, if it was easy to find my secret, there's no reason for keeping the secret, right? So on the other hand, if you have several people that have data, then the computation involved that you might be interested in doing could be a very simple one. It would still make sense. Like, for instance, the classic example where, you know, Alice wants to know whether Bob is interested in her and vice versa, right? We just need to compute the AND of two bits there. That's a really, really simple computation. And that those kinds of examples we already thought about at the time, that maybe there was something there that would make it maybe more practical than zero knowledge at the time. Of course, zero knowledge is now also much more efficient, but that was back then. Beyond that, I don't think we had any particular dreams, because you have to remember that this was pure theory at the time, right? I mean, the main result was something about, you know, how many bad players can we tolerate among this set of people, and the protocol will still work. And the actual, let's say, efficiency of the thing wasn't even something that people thought much about.
So you mentioned back then it was theoretical, and hence your imaginations weren't that wild because it were constrained by, you know, computing power. So, and then 20 years later, after the paper that put MPC on the academic map was published, the first large-scale and practical application of secure multi-party computation took place in January 2008. So can you please take us 15 years back and describe your emotions. What was going through your head on that cold Jutlandic winter day?
Yeah, so there were lots of things going through our heads. Also, of course, because that particular day when this auction, which was the application that it was running the first time, it was a long story coming up to that point. And we did talk about this at the time. I said to my fellow people in the team, that, you know, guys, we're setting a world record here. This is big. Because this was the first time that people did this in practice, of course. At the particular day where we ran the thing, it was, of course, even though you test your software and you ran the thing, you know, with mock-up data several times, it's always, you know, a bit nerve-wracking the first time you do it. But everything worked fine. And we did this auction where farmers were selling production contracts, EU production contracts, to other farmers so that you could, in this case, move the production of sugar beets to places in Denmark where it made more sense, you know. And this was a big economic incentive for the farmers at the time. In the journey leading up to this point, of course, it was, I always said, you know, in the 90s, I guess, I said several times to people that, you know, listen, digital signatures was introduced way back when, in the 70s, in fact. And it still took 20 years before they were actually implemented, used in practice, and people understood what they were and what they could do for them. And of course, MPC is a much more complicated beast. And therefore, I always thought there must be something interesting in practice to do here, but it's going to take even much more time, maybe, for MPC to come to practical use, because it's not just the fact somebody has to know how to implement the thing. It's also the fact that people out there in real life have to understand what the thing is and what it can do for them. So we finally reached that stage at that point in 2006, 2007, 2008, where we talked to these farmers and their organization, and it turns out that they have this need for a nationwide market where they can trade these things between them. And where it turns out that, in fact, privacy is an important part of it. That when I'm a farmer and I'm bidding for a contract, and it's a big part of my whole, you know, economy, what I'm willing to pay tells something about my private economic situation. And that was, in fact, something that mattered to people. Sometimes people claim that ordinary people don't care about privacy. It doesn't matter. But I think the point is that when money is involved, when it's my own resources that are involved, I think they do care. We made a survey after we ran this eco auction where we asked people, how much does it matter to you? How important is it to you that your bids remain private? And I think something like 70-something percent said it was very important or important to them. So I guess it took that long before we finally found a place where this fitted in exactly, and where with the limited tools that we had at the time, we could actually do something that would run fast enough.
You've took us back to 2008, 15 years ago, and in the very same year, what did the establishment of Partisia represent for you? And would it be fair to say that it was the very moment of MPC starting a life of its own outside the walls of the Aarhus University and as an application for millions to use?
So Partisia wasn't a big thing at first. It was a very, very small company that ran with, you know, no offices, no nothing really. Basically, just an organization that we founded based on this application with the auction there. And the first idea was just to run this auction now again for some years, which it did, in fact, on a commercial basis. Of course, we had some ideas that maybe at some point we would actually make this be a much bigger thing. But nobody had any idea how big it would become and how fast this would go. I mean, so Partisia was, in fact, the first company ever who actually wrote an invoice for MPC software. But even so, one might claim, and one might even be right about this, that maybe we're even a bit too fast to market, because again, people need to understand this thing. And we were not there at the time. So Partisia's development was very slow at first. But fortunately, we managed to stay afloat until the world changed enough for this to be successful.
If you could go back 35 years, what would you do differently about MPC? And what would today's Professor Damgård say to a 32-year-old Ivan then? So two questions, right? What would you do differently about MPC? And what would the current you say to a lot younger you then?
I'm not sure I would tell myself to do much differently. I mean, the thing is, you see, people sometimes ask me and other people in the same stage of their career, sort of how did you plan coming here? What were your ideas and stuff? And I think most of the time one will have to admit that you cannot plan very much. You meet opportunities, you seize them if you can, and then you just have to hope that things go well and that, you know, you're in the right place at the right time, which is definitely what happened to me. I was definitely at the right place at the right time at CWI back in the 80s. I think I would tell myself that, you know, don't think this is just theory. That something is going to happen. Don't worry about it. And of course, that's one thing thought you might have during the 90s, say, where things were very quiet on the MPC front, you know, don't worry about it. It's going to come alive again.
Does that mean that a 32-year-old Ivan was worried back then, and then the current Professor Damgård is a lot more relaxed now because MPC actually took a life of its own, and it's flourishing, and it's developing, and it's changing lives of many people, and it's solving a lot of problems?
So I wouldn't say I was worried back then. It was more a matter of not being sure about the future of the field of MPC, because, I mean, cryptography is a big place, and you know, we all did lots of different kinds of research, and it seemed to people that maybe MPC research, the results were coming to a halt. I mean, there wasn't that many big results coming out in the 90s. And maybe this was because many of the theoretical questions had been solved. And it was only like late in 2004-ish that people started finding new results that you know, suddenly improved the efficiency of the whole thing dramatically. So in the 90s, we couldn't have predicted this. So I would maybe have thought that, yeah, maybe we're going to do more MPC research, but maybe things will go differently. Maybe we'll do something else, right? So that's one of the things that is impossible to predict.
So 35 years on, and the MPC is gaining strength, and there are more applications being built, and with the computing power only increasing, how do you think the next 35 years will shape MPC?
So I'm not completely sure that we'll see totally new solutions. So, you know, totally new engines, you know, in the car. But I think maybe the car will change a lot, if you understand. So you know, we have lots of really efficient MPC solutions. So the software down at the bottom works very well in most cases. But the point is, how do we shape things so that they fit into the applications people actually want to run? And I think there's a lot of work to do there. It's a lot of engineering work to take this stuff and make it run in practice. There's user interface, there's interface to the businesses and people, all kinds of stuff like this that needs to be developed much more. Because currently, writing software that does MPC for a current solution requires cryptographic experts. And this is not going to scale, right? We need systems that really offer these functionalities to ordinary software developers in a way that you know, they can use it without screwing up and stuff like that. So it's really a whole new field is opening up there in MPC engineering, we could say.
So are you saying that MPC is future-proofed by default, and any future applications, any future uses that will come that are not yet invented, but the foundation is already baked in?
There is a lot of foundation baked in. I'm not saying that we can't improve. We certainly can. And there's been some exciting stuff happening in only the recent 2 years. That's a long story, but developments happened all the time. But I think a lot of the basic principles probably will not change that much. I think the major development probably in terms of enabling practical use will be on a different level, like a level closer to the people using the thing. But that's also highly non-trivial, right? Because you can't bring the whole complexity with you up to the user level, right? This is going to blow up in your face. So you really have to have some middleware that connects this the real applications to the engine below.
Of course, it's very difficult to predict the next 35 years in a world that's changing very rapidly. But so this is a question by popular demand. You have co-authored Miracle Damgård construction, which led to SHA2 family that includes SHA 256, the cryptographic hash function used within Bitcoin. Obviously, without your contribution, the level of security and trust in functions like SHA-256 and by extension the entire Bitcoin wouldn't be what it is today. So what does the future hold for Bitcoin and blockchain industry as a whole?
I think Bitcoin was a first step at making this work, and of course it contains lots of brilliant ideas. I think in the long run, I don't see Bitcoin solving more problems than what it already solves. It's such a big name that people continue using it, but I mean, the fact remains that it's generation one, and there's tons of things that can be done much better, and we know how to do better. So I think eventually, when the dust settles, I think uses will move to other places than Bitcoin, eventually, because there are so many much, much better solutions to lots of things. Blockchain as a whole, of course, things move in waves. I mean, this is always the case. I mean, we've talked about the crypto winters, which are crypto summers, I guess, also. And of course, the problem is that when something is new, you very easily get hypes. And actually, even on the upwards trend, it's not even a good thing, actually, because people create lots of expectations that cannot be fulfilled. When they find out that life is not as miraculous as they have made themselves believe, they get disappointed and they think, oh, now nothing works and it's all crap, which of course is not true either. So I think hopefully when this industry matures more, and also when the market around it matures some more, people will start seeing what the applications actually are and start, go to work and implement the damn thing and get these applications to work instead of running around after some wild imagination that isn't real anyway. So once that this thing matures more, I think we'll see a more steady development, and hopefully also some many more applications that we know exist out there.
So now a bit of a unexpected, not a question but more of a request. So I would like you to record a message to future MPC users. Well, it's an imaginary time capsule, and you are telling something that people will be watching 35 years from now. What those words would be?
Okay, so folks, this is 35 years later. I'm probably not around anymore, but I hope that you will be using MPC still, and I hope there will be tons of applications that even I could not imagine at all, and probably things will be running even faster than anybody could imagine 35 years ago.
This was Professor Ivan Damgård recollecting the 35-year history of the secure multi-party computation. So, our dear viewers, how do you think the MPC technology will change the way we interact with data? Please comment and leave your thoughts. You watched our special edition MPC at 35 with me, Bakyt Azimkanov, from the heart of Jutland in Aarhus. Until next time.